Morning. Welcome to Front Porch Gospel this morning. We're so glad to see you. So glad to have you all watching at home today. Hey, turn around, say hi to three or four or five people. Say, I'm glad you're here today. Glad the weather is so wonderful. We're going to have a great time today. Let's have a word of prayer and we will begin. God, we love you, praise you. Thank you for the privilege of being in your house today. We just ask, God, that you would have your way in this place and everything that's done in your precious name. Amen.
Life is like a mountain railway with an engineer that's free. We must make the run successful from the thank you. free. Yes, he set me free. He broke the bonds of prison for me. And I'm glory bound by Jesus to see. Oh, glory to God. He set me free. Yes, he set me free. Well, now he set me free. And he broke the bonds of prison for me. And I'm glory bound by Jesus to see. Oh, glory to God. He set me free.
Today, We're about to figure out our next song here, I promise. disciples came to land, thus obeying Christ's command, for the Master called to them to come and dine. There they found their heart's desire, bread and fish upon the fire, thus he satisfies the hungry every time. Come and dine, the Master calleth, come and dine, oh come and dine. You may feast at Jesus' table all the time. All the saints in spotless white, and with Jesus they will feast eternally. Come and dine, the Master calleth, come and dine, come and dine. You may feast at Jesus' table all the time. He who fed the multitudes turned the water into wine. To the hungry calleth now, come and dine. He who fed the multitudes turned the water.
Great job from our Front Porch Gospel Band here. Give them some appreciation. So I wanted to get into this second part of the enough series. I'm sorry.
But as Christians, we know deep down this distorted view of life isn't real life. We read what the Bible teaches and we see how Jesus lived. Every day we face a choice: to pursue the me, me, me mindset of the American dream, or to pursue Christ. What if this generation was willing to trade in the pursuit of the American dream for a world that desperately needs Christ? To be traders. A trader is a new kind of missionary. Not defined by geography. Where you live doesn't make you a missionary. The mission you're on makes you a missionary. Being a trader is a movement that requires us to live out our faith, not just talk about it. As a trader, we must choose daily to sacrifice and be intentional with our time, money, and skills. We can be like the Good Samaritan in the parable. When we're on the road of life and see someone in need, we choose to help. We follow Jesus' instructions to go and do likewise. A trader must hate injustice and find specific ways to bring the hope found in Jesus to desperate situations. It's easy to identify what you hate. What makes your heart break and your fists clench? A trader sees work as worship. Everything you do in life, including your job, can be an opportunity to worship the God who created you. Because God is glorified when we use our God-given passions and skills with excellence. And finally, a trader must act swiftly, because the time is right now. The result of all this would be a generation of traders who are making choices with their time, money, and passions that are kingdom-focused and not self-focused, so that our short time here can have an eternal impact.
It was John Hudson Taylor, the first missionary to inland China, who had said, "He is no fool who gives up that which he cannot keep in order to gain that which he cannot lose." And I believe that that is truth, especially when we're talking about this from the perspective of the gospel. And Jesus said, whosoever gains his life will lose it, but whosoever will lose his life for my sake and the gospel shall find it. And so we begin to see this, and that little clip was about making a trade of the things of this world for the things of eternity. And once you get yourself in the mindset of understanding eternity compared to the few years we have here on earth, everything changes. When you begin to grasp that and firmly believe in God's promises through Jesus Christ of eternal reward and eternal victory in Jesus Christ, then we begin to look at, how do I invest in eternity? How do I make it so that my efforts here on earth add up throughout eternity rather than just a legacy here on the planet? And so that's a little bit of what we're getting into with this series. The story in Scripture I want to share today is one of the most amazing things, I believe, and you'll see why in just a minute. You might recall this in Exodus chapter 36. A lot of you have read back in Genesis and Exodus and a lot of this. As you know, the Exodus is the book where they made their exodus out of Egypt to return back to the promised land and ended up wandering 40 years in the wilderness. But at a certain point along the way, God gave them the precise instructions for how to build the tabernacle. And it required all sorts of materials, not just basic building materials, but gold to melt down and overlay lots of the furnishings with, and jewels to use in so many of the ornate pieces of this. But it required the other metals and finely finished woods and several things like that. And here are these people out who are traveling in the wilderness. You wouldn't think they would have a whole lot to offer in terms of that. And so that's what's going on in the scripture we'll read today. A call goes out to all the people. Bring your offerings, bring money, bring jewelry, precious stones or wood or your fine linens. Bring whatever you can. And the people responded. The call went out. The offerings all started coming in. Then the most peculiar thing happened. I don't think there's another story like this anywhere in the Bible. The project managers who were doing and managing all of the building and all of the supplies came to Moses and said, tell the people to stop. Tell them to stop giving. Tell them to stop bringing their gold and silver and precious stones and wood and fine linens. We have more than enough. You've got to make them stop bringing more gifts. Think about that for just a moment. We're being inundated with offerings. We already have more than enough to do what God called us to do. Here's the scripture, chapter 36 of Exodus, starting with verse 4. So all the skilled workers who were doing all the work on the sanctuary left what they were doing and said to Moses, the people are bringing more than enough for the work the Lord commanded to be done. Then Moses gave an order, and they sent this word throughout the camp. No man or woman is to make anything else as an offering for the sanctuary. So the people were restrained from bringing more, because what they already had was more than enough to do all the work. Now, some of you guys have been attending church here or somewhere else for most of your lives, and you've probably seen finance campaigns and things like that for a building or a new addition or to catch up on something or to fund the budget, whatever. And I'm just going to guess you've never once had the pastor or some other leader get up and say, hang on, guys, stop it. No more offerings, no more checks, no more cash, no more car titles or golden rings or earrings. Nothing. No more stock certificates either. Just stop it. We've got more than enough money already. You guys keep that and do something else with it. You ever heard that happen at church? But from reading this, it seems like it's a quite viable possibility, is it not? The call went out for the materials to build the tabernacle. Everybody just started bringing stuff in. Finally, the managers of the project and the workers said, Moses, you got to talk to the people. They keep bringing all this stuff, and we've got more than enough already. Stop it. And so this is where we kind of launch into our conversation about how do we view this whole thing of generosity in our lives, and how does it affect us in our growth? And here's what I want to make a distinction between. There's one thing where you get in church and they're talking about finances and funding, and you sense just a kind of a thread of underlying manipulation to where what they're doing is they're trying to make me feel like if I don't really give sacrificially here, I'm supposed to feel guilty about it, so I'm going to give, and everybody else is going to be kind of pressured by everyone else's giving, and we're all going to do that, and they're going to get the money they want. True? You ever felt that way at church when they're asking for offerings and money? Like, I think I'm being manipulated just a little bit here, but I believe in it anyway, so I'm going to go ahead and give. You ever done that? What if we didn't do it that way? What if we did what they did here, and we just said, well, here's what the need is, guys. Y'all know what to do. And they responded. And I would say, I've seen that happen here. When we funded a new roof on the church in Zambia at Mbala, and I forget what the amount was that we wanted to raise, and I figured it would take us 6 weeks. I announced it one Sunday, and by the next Sunday, he had to say, we've already exceeded the goal, guys. Y'all can stop now. And they didn't stop. They kept giving. Or y'all did. That's the same kind of thing, is it not? Or consider this. Some of what we are experiencing now in having financial means is because of the sacrificial giving of a previous generation who have left endowments and trusts and offerings and that sort of thing, which many of you do the same kind of thing, don't you? What was really cool was when we had to pay our ransom, which, it first started out to be $223,000, and then Westpath made the adjustment. Y'all remember this, right? It ended up being like $182,000 instead. Funny thing was, we had a fund in an investment that we could not touch. And it was because I believe someone had donated a home that had been used as a parsonage, and then that was sold. And by the United Methodist guidelines, that fund, the fund from that sale, had to be put into an account that could only be used to purchase another parsonage. And so the church wasn't buying another parsonage, so they had this chunk of money sitting in an account that someone had very generously initially given with the house that was offered up, right? But what happened was, as soon as we disaffiliated, what happened to that fund? Well, it no longer had a United Methodist rule saying how it could be spent. So we used that money to pay our ransom to the United Methodist Church. Simple, right? Worked pretty well, didn't it? But because of the generosity of those who have even gone before, we didn't take any offerings for that. We didn't do any fundraising for that or anything. We just said, we're dipping into one of the pots that are already here, and we haven't been able to spend for anything in the past, but now we can spend it for this. And we did that. But look back at the people in this scripture that we just read about today. First thing I'd like to point out about them is they trusted God. Here they are trusting in God, and you might ask why or how was it they came to trust God like this? Well, for starters, these people had seen God's power. They had been in Egypt for the plagues. And they saw all the plagues come from God against Pharaoh and against the Egyptians who weren't allowing them to leave, from the frogs to the flies, the boils, and finally down to the loss of the firstborn in every household. They had witnessed all of this with total confidence that they would not be harmed, but the Egyptians would be. They crossed the Red Sea, the miraculous parting of the Red Sea, and watched God's power at work in that. They saw the Egyptian army coming at them with formidable strength. And then they saw the drowned bodies of the Egyptian soldiers washing up on the shore after the Red Sea closed back up. They'd seen the plagues, they'd seen the Passover. And I'll say this, many of you have also seen God's power. Many of you have either yourself or a family member or a loved one have been diagnosed with a cancer that was inoperable, been involved in prayer over that, and gone back, and they couldn't find it. The number of times I've seen cancer just disappear as a result of prayer, and saying, well, we were prepping for surgery and all of these things, and yet now we can't find any cancer. We've seen God's power that way. So many times we've watched God work through situations that we found ourselves in and have delivered us. We've seen God's power when someone we thought was beyond redemption came to faith in Jesus Christ and had their life completely transformed. That might describe some of you who are here right now. You've seen God's power, therefore you know you can trust God for the issues that are in front of you. That's what these people did. And they realized this wasn't about Moses, but it was about the mission. You see, these same people who brought these generous offerings had just been complaining about Moses a week or two earlier, griping about the horrible leadership God had given them, thinking somebody else needed to take over and put Moses aside. This wasn't about Moses. It wasn't about his leadership. God dealt with that in another way. Moses didn't need to. God dealt with it. It wasn't about him. It was about the mission. And God worked in the hearts of the people. All Moses needed to do was he communicated the need. He just said, here's what we need, everybody, and here's God's instructions. Because I'm sure he started listing off the needs and everybody stood around for a minute and said, where do you expect we're going to get all this stuff? And he says, well, most of it's going to come from the stuff you have out of your pockets. It's funny, I was doing a building project at a church several years ago, and I have one of the guys come in who had been a renowned multimillionaire since he was a young guy, and he was in his later years at this point. And he came in and said, I just want to know where all this money's going to come from. I said, well, I figure some of it's going to come out of your bank account, isn't it? And he just kind of smiled and said, yeah, believe it will. You know? And there you go. He believed in what we were doing. He said, I'd pay for the whole thing if you put my name on it. We didn't. But Moses just had to communicate the need. Usually if we do that, people respond. He just announced what was needed. The people responded, didn't they? Imagine that. I don't think we've done any kind of a financial drive in the 3 years I've been here. And not really doing that now, but through September, I'm kind of talking about our stewardship a little bit, just to let you know, for one thing, to let you know how much the generosity of the people in this church is so appreciated. And to also communicate that I've watched, and any time a need here is presented, everybody responds to that. Just like, again, the church in Zambia, everybody would just instantaneous in their response for that. And, of course, big priority here has been having a working elevator. We mentioned that and the overall cost and everything. People have responded to that. It just happens, doesn't it? We don't have to pressure anybody. And that's what I'm convinced of. In the church, there's never a need to browbeat one another over financing anything or money. We simply communicate the needs, and people will give as the Holy Spirit guides them and leads them to do that. And some people say, well, I don't think the Spirit's guiding me or leading me at all. Well, hey, that's just fine too, because that's the whole idea. If God isn't leading you to do it, what would be the point? We've got to trust God to lead one another, that the Holy Spirit can speak to someone else the same as they can speak to you or I, but it may not be the same message. It may not be exactly the same, that we just believe God in this. And obviously, there would never be a time when we would speak financially and expect any guest visiting the church or just, you know, visiting with family or something like that to contribute or support the ministries here. That wouldn't be something we would expect a guest or visitor to have a commitment to. However, those who have pledged themselves and become members here and committed to that, obviously they would want to. So there's a big difference there. And the other thing I would say about this and the congregation at this point was the capacity to give was already there among the people. They had the capacity to do this. They may not have known it. The capacity then, their capacity was greater than what they knew it was. Most places that's true. Imagine this, out on the desert, traveling. Who would have imagined that the people had all of that with them? And yet they did, and they had it in enough abundance that they could give it away and not even be hurt by that. Who would have thought? So, a couple of questions. What would happen with us if God had 100% of who we are? 100% of my heart, my ambitions, my goals, my energy, everything about me was 100% given over to God. What would happen if he was really first in our lives? What would happen if we really trusted in God and believed God for the part that we're playing in eternity right here and now? See, the real question here was their willingness to release some of what they possessed and watch how God used it and worked with it and multiplied their offerings to meet the need. That's what we miss out on when we don't go ahead by faith and participate in something like this, isn't it? But when we do release some and trust God with that, we watch how God's working through others, and we watch how it's all multiplied, and we watch how the needs are met, and ministry just blossoms in that environment. And I would say this, after reading this, I could say, we're not really overextended and we're not really tapped out, are we? I mean, we've got more in the tank than what we realize. You get right down to it. If we had to do something, we could. If we had to come up with funding for something new and big and different, we'd find a way to do it. And it would be mostly because of the generosity of the individuals who are part of this church, wouldn't it? And the other thing I would say about this is, this, my friends, was a free will offering. There wasn't anyone who went around to every tent there and said, now your share is going to be this much. There wasn't any of that. It was a free will offering. I'm going to say a couple of things here that might shock you. First one is this. No one owes the church any money. Nobody owes the church money. I've heard it said, well, you've been here, you've benefited from all these ministries, and you've been a recipient of all these blessings. You owe it to support things and start giving. That might be someone's opinion, but nobody owes the church anything, do they? All of Christianity is free will exercise of aligning ourselves with the calling and the purpose of God. If we make it a rule and we force people to do it, it's no longer free will, and it's no longer responding to God, is it? It's responding to peer pressure or guilt or manipulation, which is exactly what we want to avoid. But yeah, stick with this. Nobody owes the church any money. And get this, the church operates on a different standard than all the rest of the world. There's nobody collecting. There's nobody sending out notice saying your share of the total annual budget is this many dollars, anything like that. Not going to happen. Because we trust God that the free will generosity of God's people is always going to be sufficient for the needs of ministry. We saw it here in Exodus, one of the first great examples of that. They finally had to just say, guys, your generosity is so appreciated, but you can quit now. We might need some of that later on another time. Just hang on to what you got because you've already given more than enough. That's a good message, isn't it? You've already given way more than we need. But notice this. The scripture says, when the call went out and the need was announced, that their hearts were stirred. And this is why they started responding and giving. Has God ever just stirred up your heart over a need? You've seen someone or a community or whatever in a horrible situation, or like the situation in Maui that we've recently witnessed, or some other disaster, and maybe every time it doesn't happen, but suddenly this time God just stirred your heart and you said, I've got to help this time. That's what happened here. God stirred their hearts and they all responded, and that's how it worked. You see, when God stirs up your heart within you, it's important for us to act then, isn't it? But with that comes the faithful promise of God and God's long-awaited answer to the shortage churches have been caught up in. When we just respond to the needs of ministry and let God stir our hearts to respond in that way, we don't run on scarcity and shortage. We operate on an abundance. What a blessing it was to be able to just go to one of the accounts and utilize that fund to pay the, what, $182,000 we had to pay to the Missouri Annual Conference when it was time to do that. That only happened because there had been previous generosity, just like there's generosity today. I hope that a generation from now, a big need comes up like that, they can simply say, we've had previous members who helped us plan for a rainy day, and we have a fund for this. It'll happen. It'll happen because of your generosity. But here's what I'd like to wrap up with and something to take home. It's simply this. God asked for a bounty, even out here in the desert, from people who would presumably have nothing. But it was the response of the people that really made it happen. Here's the question. Are we willing to see or discover what we're capable of and what God will do through us? We're about to embark on new approach to some ministries. We are in a situation of freedom the church hasn't seen since back in the 1960s. We have great people here. We have lots of vision here. We have so many opportunities for ministry. And so we're going to begin doing some things like that and sort of mobilizing the congregation to be able to witness and invite people and equipping you to do this. And I'm saying, stay on board with us. Invite your friends. Really interesting, really exciting things are going to be happening here, and you'll be able to watch God's power and God's hand at work in your life and in the lives of everyone in this church. Let me ask you to pray with me now, okay? Okay.